it's a real privilege to bring God's word, and I thank your pastor in charge. Well, actually, my pastor in charge also. I'm attached here as an elder, retired. And so when he asked me if I could share the pulpit today, he's my new PIC. How can I say no? Okay, so that's why I'm here. All right. Let's go to God in prayer. May the words of my mouth, meditations of all our hearts, be acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I'll remove my mask. I hope it doesn't stumble anybody. And hope you all don't remove your mask also. Okay? So that you can see me smile while I'm preaching and be encouraged. Otherwise, you don't know whether I'm scowling or what, you know. Today's sermon is entitled Come. And it comes from Jesus' very own... Pardon for the pun. It comes from Jesus' very own words in Matthew chapter 11, verse 28, where he says, Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You know, this reminds me of an old favorite hymn. Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling.
Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me.
See on the portals. He's watching.
He's waiting.
Waiting and watching.
And watching. Watching
for you.
For you.
And for
me. And for me.
Saying,
Come home. Come home, ye who are weary, come home.
Those who are weary, come.
Earnestly, tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling, oh sinners, come.
Thank you for all of you who are here. You have come for this service physically, as well as those who have joined us on the live stream. You know, on the cross, Jesus, represented by the Chinese character Ren, is crucified. And beside him hung two others. Let's just call them Xiao Ren. And this is together the Chinese character for lie. The old traditional Chinese character in my days, this is lie. It's for come. Such a simple and profound graphic of Jesus' invitation to come from the scene of Calvary. And it's so appropriate to usher in the Chinese New Year in a few days' time, right? Especially when you have reunion dinner, like come back tomorrow night for a reunion. But just many have already started their reunion dinners. Now, despite safe distancing restrictions still in place this year, God's word for us today is Laiba. Come, rest for those wearied and burdened by this pandemic. Good news is soon becoming endemic. I guess the word end there means it's coming to an end. Endemic. Sorry, that's another pun. But what's interesting about this come rest in verse 28 is the context of Matthew chapter 11 that begins in verse 2 to verse 6 with a question from John. And that question is, are you, asking Jesus, the Messiah we've been expecting and looking for all these years? Or should we keep looking for someone else? This is John, the forerunner of Jesus. And this is the one that has declared to everybody, behold, when he's pointed to Jesus, behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. But now, how to continue fulfilling his calling and destiny to prepare the way for the Messiah, for the Lord, when he is stuck in prison? So he must be feeling very discouraged, very frustrated. And so he sends this question to Jesus. Are you the one? How come you didn't come and rescue me so that we can continue this teamwork? And how tragic it is to say, should we be looking for another one? He had questions. How Jesus answered this question, I leave for you to read for yourself, okay? Because we do not have time to go through the whole chapter. I just highlight the different sections that form the context for the verse for today. Come. Now, this question that John posed through his disciples impacted the crowd and stirred doubts they had about John. And doubts about the messenger will inevitably lead to doubts about the one that he is trying to usher in, the Messiah himself, Jesus. So Jesus addresses this in verse 7 to 15. Again, that you would take time to read for yourself. Fascinating reading of the Word of God. And then he went further to deal with three characteristics of crowds. The first, in verse 16 to 19, it's the childish criticism of styles. And then the second characteristic, unbelief. In verse 20 to 24, unbelief in those privileged to have seen miracles, what Jesus has done. Again, read for yourself. Fascinating how Jesus address this. And finally, in verse 25 to 27, blindness in those too learned to see. None as blind as those who choose not to see. And then in the very next verse, verse 28, Jesus says, come to me, all who weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Yes, it's all right to come, even if you have questions like John had. Are you the one? Because when you come to Jesus, he will clear those questions. Doubts? Come, they'll be clarified. Jesus will clarify them for you. Critical spirit still can come, but be curbed. And even if unbelieving and blinded, come, rest from all your struggles. Then Jesus continued with verse 29. The chapter doesn't end there. With the second rest, take my yoke upon you and learn from me. For I am gentle and lowly or humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. And verse 30, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. You know, the first rest is a gift. It's a gift given by virtue of you deciding to come. The second rest is different. You need effort to find that second rest. How? How to find this rest for your souls? The answer, take my yoke and learn from me. And I've shown you a picture of the yoke. It's a harness, a frame or a bar that joins two animals to balance the burden and to ease the load that they are pulling. It's an imagery of submission to Jesus, yoked to him, to learn from him, and to be, the word is, discipled by him. In Greek, it is matete. To be disciple. We talk a lot about discipleship. Here Jesus, it says, take my yoke, learn from me, be discipled by me. Listen, there are three possible yokes. The first one we've seen, the one from Jesus, his yoke is, in verse 30, easy, and his burden is light. And you'll find rest for your souls, not the other two. The other two, not only not easy nor light, they can also crush you. One of them is other people's expectations on you. On you to perform. They use the word KPI, key performance indicators. That's one. The other one is expectation placed on yourself by your very own self. Question. Which is worse? Yoke from others that they place on you, or your own yoke that you place on yourself? I wonder, what is your answer? But if anyone is pointing a finger at others, let me remind you, you've got three fingers pointing back. Okay, you didn't get that. All right, never mind. From my own experience, and experience in counseling, our own yokes on ourselves are more demanding, and some are so hard and harsh on ourselves that it's cruel. I'm not suggesting the opposite and becoming self-indulgent. But that's why people commit suicide. They can't face the disappointment of failure, of failed personal expectations. And that's why Jesus invites you to take his yoke and let him disciple you. Jesus says, my yoke will never crush you. And you know why? There, it's in that verse. One of those verses where Jesus personally revealed the kind of person he is, his character. He says, I am gentle and humble or lowly in heart, and I will never crush you. I'll never put a load on you that is too heavy. Not the demanding taskmasters. And nothing as severe as the taskmaster of our own pride that can't handle failures. The voice within, silent but severe, failed. Loser. Jump. Commit suicide. Recently, I was in the home of someone who told me he's about to jump. I rushed up. this person pointed to me. He's drinking himself drunk. And the reason, which I didn't know, was when he's so numbed with drunk, when he's jumped and he's falling. Sometimes you fall halfway, you change your mind and say, I changed my mind. Too late. But when you are numbed by that drunkenness, you just go right through. Tragic to hear of that. So today, whether you are wearied with questions and doubts, and burdened or frustrated by criticism, okay, people can criticize, but none more severe than your own criticism of yourself, your self-criticism, and an unbelieving heart, or just plain myopic. Today, if you are in any of these conditions, Jesus is calling to you softly and tenderly. Come home. Come home. You who are weary, come home. Come rest. The next stanza in this song, why should you tarry when Jesus is pleading? Pleading for you and pleading for me. Why should we linger and heed not his mercies? His mercies in the outstretched arm on the cross. Mercies for you and for me. I like this passage of Matthew 11:28-30. In the Eugene Peterson's Message paraphrase, it goes like this. Are you tired, worn out, burnt out on religion? Oh, religion can be a very harsh taskmaster. You know why? Because God says so. Oh, you cannot argue against God. So, you take on the expectation and the KPIs. So you can be burnt out on religion. But Jesus says, in a paraphrase, come to me. Get away with me. And you'll receive your life. I'll show you how to take a real rest. And verse 29, walk with me and work with me. Watch how I do it. Learn the unforced rhythms of grace. What an amazing turn of phrase. Are we living lives yoked to Christ that demonstrates unforced rhythms of grace, the grace of God in our lives? I won't lay anything heavy or ill-fitting on you. Verse 30, keep company with me and you'll learn to live freely and lightly. Amazing words, rephrased to give us life, to give us hope in whatever situation that you may be going through. Let me close with two more verses. First, in Jeremiah 6, verse 16. This is what the Lord says. Stand at a crossroads and look, ask for the ancient path. And I thought, crossroads? Hey, we're right here in the crossroads between the last Sunday of the old lunar year and the new Sunday, next Sunday of the new lunar year. Sounds to me like crossroads. Would you take position? Would you stand? Would you look? Because sometimes you may not be in position, and sometimes you may be in position, but you're not looking. You're distracted with so many things. This is what the Lord says. Stand at a crossroads and look. But besides looking, ask. Because you can look, but you're not asking. And Matthew 7 is saying, Jesus saying, ask and it shall be given you. So ask. Ask for what? Ask for the ancient parts. Ask for the good way and walk in it. And the promise, you will find rest for your souls. Wait a minute. Doesn't this look like Jesus is quoting in Matthew 11 from this verse in Jeremiah in his Hebrew Bible we call the Old Testament? This good way is an ancient path. And when you walk in it, God promises you find rest for your souls. But you know, this verse in Jeremiah 6 doesn't end there. There's one more line, and it's a tragic end to this verse. It says, but you say, we will not walk in it. May it not be true for us. And so for those people in those days where this was recorded, they did not enter into God's promised rest. Which is why here in Matthew chapter 11 verse 28, Jesus is inviting us to this promise. This promise that's found on this ancient path of walking in a way that is good by being yoked to Christ, submitted to Christ, discipled by Christ. The second verse is from Micah chapter 6, verse 8. Okay, somebody pointed out that it looked like a 6-6. Oh yeah, it looks like 6-6. Please listen to what I say rather than what you see. Okay, it's Micah 6:8. And this verse actually answers the question, what is this good way? Micah 6:8 has this to say, he, God, has told you, O man, what is good? And what does the Lord require of you that is good? Three things. Do justice. Do what is right. Love kindness or love mercy. And thirdly, to walk humbly with your God. Now, in the closing moments, let's apply this to Holland Village Methodist Church, to this vision month of our church. Our PIC, pastor in charge, began the year with this vision: nourish to flourish. Actually, we should all be saying it. How come I'm the only one saying? This is our church, right? Okay, so one, two, go. Nourish to flourish, building up and reaching out to every generation. And it covers five key areas: rebuilding worship. You know, that's the most visible part of our church life. You want to go and see Holland Village Church, where do you go and see? On Sunday, here. This is the most visible part of our church life. And thank God we have got a virtual platform through live streaming, but nothing beats being here physically present. And with the recent announcement by our pastor, there will be certain restrictions But nothing beats being physically present. Rebuilding worship. Second, reclaiming life groups where the nourishing of our spiritual life, they best take place there in life groups. Third, rediscovering serving, service, serving for the joy of blessing others. Rather than we come with a gimme, gimme, gimme mindset, like some of our prayers, it's all gimme, gimme, gimme. And we come to get, rather than to give. Rediscovering the joy of serving. Fourthly, reviewing our ministry to ACS International. You know why? Because this is our most immediate mission field. We're here. This premises is where 6 days a week the school exists. They don't on Sunday, so we take the opportunity to use the premises to worship for the most visible, physical aspect of our church life. And lastly, revitalizing our youth. You know why? Because our future lies there. And it's so heartening for me to just discover a moment ago that our worship leader is doing IB2 this year. So she's one of our youth. Praise the Lord. She's begun this month worship leading, and this month worship leading is what the Chinese call Utao Bui. So, applying today's message, God's word to you. Come. Will you come to rebuild worship? Will you come to reclaim life for yourself in life groups? Will you come to rediscover the joy of serving, of giving? Will you come reviewing and renewing our ministry to our most immediate neighbor, ACS International? Will you come to revitalize our future in our youth? Encourage them. Give them opportunities to be nourished and to flourish. And in so doing, I'm sure you would also be nourished to flourish. Two takeaway questions. One, what holds you back from coming to Jesus? His word to you is, come to me. Take my yoke and you find rest. What holds you back? Is it fear? Is it I'm not adequate? You don't know, I'm very, very small. I just crawl into church and crawl out of church. Because I see myself very small. Well, read Matthew 11. There is something there for the least in the kingdom of heaven. Jesus has a word for you there. Second question, who can you share this in confidence? Okay, because it can be a very personal reason. Okay, who can you share? Is there somebody in our midst here, maybe in your life group, that you can share this confidentially? Why? So that you can receive support in your efforts to keep coming. Come, 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 keep coming. And that's how you overcome. You get it? It's like kill, 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 then overkill. Okay, somebody is telling me maybe kill is not a very good word. Flow, 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 overflow. Sounds better? That's the idea. Come and be an overcomer. You know, we've just finished the first month of 2022. For the remaining 11 months, would you also consider coming for John chapter 20, verse 22. Someone sent me this in the beginning of the year. We're in a year 2022. Look at what John 20, 22 has to say. Jesus breathed upon his disciples and said, "Receive the Holy Spirit." And so in the remaining months, would you come and be open to the Spirit of God, breathing into your lives? And this is my prayer for each one of you as we close through this song. It's a good thing I removed my mask so you can see. I'm not singing, okay? it's in the embedded music. Come. Come see. Come see with spirit eyes. Come see, the door is open. Door of opportunities is open.
Come near. Come weary and ashamed.
For those weary and ashamed, come.
His arms are open. His arms are open.
Come live. There is freedom in Christ.
The chains are broken.
Whatever chains, they can be broken.
Come rest. Come take His gift of grace. Come rest. The word is spoken. The word is spoken.
I like the music. It's like left, right,
come
left,
see.
Right. Coming.
Come see with spirit eyes. Come see. The door is open.
Can you see? The doors are open. Come home.
Come lay your burdens down. Come home. His arms are open. His arms are open. His arms.
I pray this image of come, of arms open for you, will remain with you. Thank you, Jesus, for your arms stretched out to invite us to come. There is no rejection, there is no condemnation. He's paid the price for you at Calvary. On the cross, arms outstretched to show you that's how much He loves you. How can we thank you enough, Lord, for these outstretched arms welcoming us into your presence, welcoming us to take your yoke and to be yoked with you as we seek to build this church, as we seek to prepare the bride of Christ to respond to you when you say, I'm coming soon. Thank you, Lord, that your message and good news of welcome is not just only for people who have yet to believe in you, but for people who have believed in you and faithfully served you all these years, but have become weary, tired, doesn't help with the pandemic. Come, his arms are open. There is rest as a gift, and there's rest when you are yoked with him, when you submit yourself to his mission in your submission. Thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.